Welcome, everybody. Wait a second here for jump in.
Morning, everyone. George, did you want to kick us off? Oh, perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. I wanted to introduce our first luncheon series of 2022 for the Washington chapter of ICEAA. Today, we're going to have Ed Spriggs and Kevin McKeel from Logapps presenting the evolving role of software cost estimator. And much of this presentation is going to be a video series of people from the industry talking about software cost estimating and best practices. And I'm going to introduce here the two speakers. We have Ed Spriggs, who's a managing partner at Logapps and a co-founder of Logapps, where he's been responsible for researching and analysis of IT software acquisition programs for the Department of Defense, the federal judiciary, and civilian agencies. He has over 20 years of experience with federal acquisition and business case analysis and cost estimation. And Kevin McKeel, who is also a co-founder and managing partner of Logapps, and he's responsible for the growth and management of the firm, as well as customizing unique client solutions. He has more than 25 years of experience in the management consulting and IT cost estimating, and he directs Logapps software analyses for clients like the IRS, US courts, US Navy, Coast Guard, Army, and Department of Homeland Security. He's also a CCEA certified cost estimator. I'll go ahead and hand it over to you guys for a second. If anything else you want to mention, we can get.
Let's see. I think we're going to Daniel.
Yep.
Yeah. Thanks very much, George, and you know, thanks Ed Kevin for presenting today. Thanks for everybody for attending. Really looking forward to hearing the presentation and getting some feedback from everyone. This is our first event of the year since we've sort of changed leadership in the local chapter. So I just wanted to briefly, introduce the new leadership of the chapter. We've got them there on the screen, along with some goals we have for 2022. You know, a lot of people took a survey already that we issued a little earlier in the year, and we really took that feedback to heart. And you know, we've started planning events in accordance with sort of what folks have mentioned. I also wanted to note that I'm really proud that the chapter has got a real diversity on its board and in its leadership between organizations, both DOD and several different folks on the contractor side, which I really think is important for ICEAA in order to ensure that we're all sort of learning and growing together. As we are ramping up activities in this year, and as we're planning things on the calendar, all of the chapter or all the committee chairs could certainly use some help. So if you're a local member and you want to help out, or if you've got a topic that you think sounds interesting, drop a note to one of us or to that email below. And we really look forward to working with you and providing some really great content over these next couple of years. Next slide, please. With that in mind, we do ask a standard set of survey questions after each of these luncheons. It's really great for us to judge feedback, and we do use it to shape an award that we give out each year for best survey. So don't fill it out now because you haven't heard it yet, but just note that we will ask that you fill out that really brief survey at the end of this, and then we'll talk a little bit more about the some other things we've got going on in the chapter, and then we're going to try to have a virtual mingling session for a few minutes if folks want to just meet and greet or talk shop. The kinds of things we would have done could we be in person, but due to COVID we can't. We'll try to get some of that today as well, time allowing. But enough from me. Let's get on to the good content. Ed and Kevin, please, over to you. Okay.
Thanks, Daniel. Give me just one second here. Okay, go ahead, Kevin.
Okay, I want to thank everyone for joining us today. It looks like we got a lot of people on online. We're going to be talking about the changing role in planning and analysis in software development and acquisition. We'll be talking about things like the agile methodology, changing expectations, what kind of skill sets are required, AI, and also we'll close on sort of the future of the field and also actually touch on CBOC as well. So we have eight different videos we're going to go into, and Ed and I will be talking briefly about each video. And please pop in with any questions you have in chat, and we'll try to address them. So we had a set of six questions we're going to go through, and I believe our SMEs are introduced on the next page, many of whom are actually members of ICEAA. So you can see Cammy and Katie over at the IRS, Dave Underwood, Alan Cole, Dave Seaver, Tyrese, Dan French, and Ian Brown. I think I hit everyone. We're going to be talking about things like, is IT cost estimation overdue for modernization? The tools that are used, how can they be better used? What techniques are going to be needed going forward? Things of that nature, kind of things that you hear a lot about at the annual ICEAA conference. So we feel like this is a very topical topic to go into to discuss with everybody.
Yeah, and just to add to that, what you're going to see is really a mashup of the responses to the questions that we asked them. So there is a good deal of editing that we put into this, and really the reason why we did that is just to cut down on the time and to get to the meat of the responses. So with that, we'll start with the introductions, and hopefully this works.
I'm David Seaver. I'm presently the strategic estimation lead and subject matter expert for software estimation at General Dynamics Information Technology.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here today. I've been with DHS now for 11 years, and it's been phenomenal. I'm thrilled with the opportunity to make a difference at DHS.
All right, I'm Dave Underwood from the IRS Estimation Program Office. I'm the acting manager. We support the IRS in developing cost estimates for in-flight and candidate proposals and projects.
Pleasure to be here. My primary client is the Investment Planning Analysis Group, whose responsibility is to review all the program estimates and get them through the acquisition management system that we have at the agency.
Hello, my name is Cammy. Excited to be here. Thanks for the opportunity. I have over 10-year background in cost estimating, a background of DOD. I've been at DHS now a little over 3 years.
My name is Tyrese Johnson. I work with FTI Frontier Technology, where we primarily focus on operations research, technology innovation, and data analytics.
Hi, my name is Alan Cole. I'm a senior cost analyst in the IRS Estimation Program Office.
Hi, my name is Ian Brown, and I am the Director of Federal Civil Markets with Avantis Federal.
My original background is mechanical engineering. I've been the past president of IFPUG, the International Function Point Users Group. I've been involved, fortunately, in the International Organization for Standardization and International Electrotechnical Commission on ISO IEC standards in software and systems engineering for more than 25 years.
So you can see we have a interesting cross section. We have people from government agencies like DHS, contractors, folks that are experts in functional sizing, and I think that group you'll see has a wide variety of opinions that we'll get into shortly.
Yeah. Okay. Let me see here.
So the first topic is going to be on the Agile methodology.
Yeah. Okay.
NSA was pretty much all Agile or DevOps. GDIT has a very strong Agile development practice. It depends on the government customer and clients.
Probably about like 25% of our programs, our major acquisitions, have some, whether they are completely software development or they have some type of software development aspect to them.
Yeah, I think all the programs are using some flavor of Agile, though I believe it's mostly a hybrid Agile.
Well, I am a certified Scrum Master, And our use of Agile at the agency has been minimal for the most part.
All of our IT programs are new. IT programs are really embracing and adapting both the DevSecOps and the Agile methodologies.
Okay. All right, great. So let me just say real quick, if you have any questions, please type them into the chat and we'll take them as they come in. Okay. So we got, you know, really good responses on the Agile methodology. As you could tell, a lot of what folks are experiencing is really a hybrid. And in some cases, it's very minimal amount of Agile that they're seeing at their program offices and at their customer sites. This came as something of a surprise to us. We did think that we were going to see a lot more implementation of Agile, a much more mature process, but that actually didn't turn out to be true.
So some agencies, NSA and DHS, seem a little bit further down the learning curve, definitely using Agile. Dan noted the FAA really not using it that much. So one thing to keep in mind is that there is not consistency in where the agencies are in Agile. The one thing everyone agrees is that going forward, most of the software programs will be developed using the Agile methodology. And I thought Cami made an excellent point that the DevSecOps will change the way estimates are done because it changes the way development teams are and operations teams are organized.
Okay, all right. So the next video that we're going to show is just a further elaboration on this same question, I believe. Oh, actually, no. That takes care of number two, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think you're going to changing customer expectations.
Thanks. All right. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So here we're asking the question, how have client expectations of software cost estimation deliverables changed? So really what we wanted to know was, from your customer's point of view, how do they see the software cost estimator? What types of different needs do they have, since they might be implementing in an Agile environment or just doing things different? I'll go ahead and run this.
So you are seeing in the current set of proposals things like automatic dashboards and tracking and planning and oversight.
There is a change in how the program managers interact with the support contractors within the Defense Healthcare Agency. We are set up to be innovative. We're set up to utilize technology to help generate solutions so that the leadership on the federal government side can make well-informed decisions. That's very different than what it used to be. We tend to have contract support who primarily focus on task. And on those basis, we evaluated whether they were being successful or not. That is not the case working with the Defense Healthcare Agency.
I think anything can use some modernization. Moving more towards data analysis, being able to rely on that better. I think there's an incremental process to it that you need to have the data in such a form that it can be used, and then you have to be able to use it, and then you have to be able to incorporate that into how you use that in your processes. I think that is the way to go about getting more done with less people.
Model-based cost estimation is going to have to evolve to be able to accommodate those types of approaches that federal customers are asking for. We have to keep up with the technology and the delivery. We have to be able to connect the effort and the dollars and cents to what it is that the client's looking at.
Ian Brown, interestingly, was a little bit reddish there. I don't know if that was his actual skin tone at that time, We did do this over the summer, so he may have been burnt. I'm not sure. Kevin, did you you want to chime in on this?
Yeah, so I think some of the things that came out of visit were we're seeing tools like automated dashboards more than just pure estimates. I thought Tyrese made some excellent points that, you know, in his case, contractors are having more of an active role in the ideation and helping their customers along. I thought that was an important point.
Okay.
I had a quick question. Did you all, did the folks you interviewed, did they get a sense that the requirements process for software would be changing in order to become a little bit more agile? You know, you think about some of our major acquisition programs, they you know, have a requirement in mind from the onset, which often promotes itself to, you know, the legacy waterfall. Is there any idea from those folks that are establishing requirements or writing the contract that they are willing to accept or work with a more agile process, or is it, or are we going to have the same firm and fixed requirements process just executed in a more agile way? Did anybody have any good feedback on that?
I mean, I would say the latter point, that you're going to have, you know, some waterfall characteristics in terms of milestones are still going to exist because of the, it's kind of a, you can't really get around that very easily with government acquisition. And I think some of our folks touched on that. There are obviously, if you have the ability, you'll get into epics and features and user stories, but not in all cases.
Yeah, that's a really good point, Daniel. I think Dave Siever talks about it in one of the later snippets that we have. But I think he was really one of the that mentioned requirements, but yeah, I thought that was something that would be top of mind for most people, but I don't think many people spend a whole lot of time talking about requirements per se.
Awesome, thank you.
Okay, anybody else? Or Megan, do we have the floor open to people?
Can we people do, get- but we haven't gotten any questions yet.
Okay, are we getting anything on the chat or anything?
I'm no. Troubleshooting a tech issue with somebody.
Okay.
<All right. laughs> So it's working.
All right, good. All right, well, if you have questions, then throw them into the chat and we'll get them answered. Okay, so the next question that we asked our panelists was about changing skill sets. So we wanted to see what types of new ideas were coming from the talent that they were recruiting. So this was really the idea was to get an idea as to what they're seeing from the younger generation, what they're seeing from people that are right out of school that might be data analysts and things like that. So I'll run that.
I do see a lot of folks coming in with data analytics on top of their baseline of skill sets. But I think one of the most important things is the ability to be inquisitive, the ability to understand tech, and the ability to sell, like be a storyteller and sell your analysis.
You can't just sit in your office and look at your spreadsheets. You need to be talking to all the subject matter experts. You need to be going to IPTs. You need to be looking at systems engineering documents and reading technical documentation and talking to those folks and really integrating yourself with the program office. Getting outside of your cost bubble is really going to make you a better analyst overall and just a better product and better asset to our programs.
What I'm finding to be a unique balance is having folks who understand the fundamentals of cost estimating and analysis. On my team, I have folks who are engineers by education, economists, statisticians, financial planners or managers, and the like. The uniqueness that I appreciate there is that they also come with experiences that extremely vary.
At this day and age, I see a lot of people with strong technical backgrounds or technical and business backgrounds as joint degrees joining the community. I also see the need for people with a data background, because the information you're going to need to teach yourself how your projects have performed historically is now starting to be coming out of technical products and services.
I've seen a lot more focus on the younger analysts today on data analytics, bringing new tools to the table like natural language processing and machine learning. Those have become really game changers.
I want somebody who can speak business to business, speak IT with IT, and translate between the two.
One of the first skills I look at when I'm trying to get a new estimator on board is what are their reading skills and their analysis skills on the reading, and then how quickly can they get up to speed technically on what the problem set is they're dealing with. So I think the cost estimates of the future, anybody that's going to support those is going to need to have familiarity both with the IT side and the software side in order to do their job effectively.
The skills I want to see if somebody coming into our office are soft skills. I want to see sense of urgency. I want to see organization, attention to detail. I want to see the determination to succeed. This is not an easy business.
In the field of cost estimation, you need to be a solid problem solver and not be, you know, stuck in one way or another, because so many different things are popping up all the time. I think being able to adapt and adjust and to see things differently is really important. Being able to speak the language of the technology, understanding what's going on in the technology marketplace.
Okay.
So I think we saw a couple different things there. We saw definitely a lot of people coming into the industry are going to have data analytics certifications, experience, in addition to the sort of the STEM background you're looking for in most cost estimators. Dave talked about people that can marry up the business and functional side along with the IT, having that understanding, but yet still soft skills are important. You need to be able to sell. You need to be able to communicate. And also, like what Cammy said, get out of your cost bubble. Everyone who's new to the industry, if you're new to software estimation, really try to understand know the technical team, try to understand the solutions that are being built. I think that's very important.
Yeah, I think interestingly, more than one panelist that talked about the language that they're using. So there was a lot of equating language with knowledge, really, I think, or the perception of knowledge. So I think a lot of our panelists had in mind that they wanted folks to support them that could represent their organization well, both to the business and also to the technology people.
I had one quick question on that one. It was interesting. Everything that I think I heard from those panelists sounded like good advice for really any type of cost estimator, not particularly a software cost estimator. Once or twice, somebody sort of mentioned knowledge of the field, and that's probably applicable in other types of estimating as well. You know, as a non-software smart analyst, I guess that gives me hope that maybe I could be trained to do software cost estimating, and there's no fundamental defect that I would need to fix or have had fixed earlier in my life in college in order to do software cost estimating. Is that the sense that really any cost estimator can be a software cost estimator? They just maybe need to you know, bone up on a little bit of the specifics of software, the same way they might have to bone up on the specifics of manufacturing or of facility production if they were going to estimate those types of things?
Well, yeah, I definitely think so. So first of all, some of the folks and that were in our panel had liberal arts degrees. There were a few, you know, I know Cammy is a systems engineer. A couple others had technical degrees. A lot of people that are in software estimation kind of learned it on, you know, they might have had little experience development. They might just had an inquisitive mind. So I think certainly anyone that has the ability to, you know, the skills as a cost estimator and understands tech or wants to understand tech, they can definitely make that transition.
Yeah. First off, that's a really good point that you're making, Daniel. And just to add to what Kevin is saying, yeah, I mean, we've known some of these folks for quite some time, and yeah, their backgrounds are usually in business, and like Kevin was saying, in liberal arts. They either stumbled into software cost estimation, or it was something that they pursued. They decided that they wanted to go into software cost estimation. But I know for many folks, they go into cost estimation and start estimating a weapon system, for example. And the weapon system will have some component within it that is software intensive. And then that's the way that they get into software cost estimation, is by being given a task to maybe a narrow task to do a software cost estimate as part of a larger estimate for a platform, for instance. But no, there's no magic that's required to become a software cost estimator. And I think the panelists were really good about explaining what types of skills software cost estimators need in general. And it's just basic analyst skills, and it starts with listening.
I thought Ian and Dave made excellent points that the traits they're looking for are ability to problem solve. And if you think about technology is moving so quick, the tools that we're using are not moving quickly at all. So it definitely, if you're going to get into software cost estimating, just the ability to understand the problem and problem solve, as our panelists pointed out, that's really important.
Yeah. And it doesn't hurt to also have an interest in IT as well.
No.
Okay. So this, yeah, absolutely. Keep the questions coming. So this next question really is not, this presentation was originally done for Jazzy, which is a DHS sponsored organization that focuses on software cost estimating. We wanted to know what type of impact membership in Jazzy had, and you can kind of sense what types of impact any industry organization would have on the field by listening to the responses here. So I'll roll this.
Started out with four of us at ITCast in 2018 when we were sitting around at a table talking about this, again, DHS, NSA, and NGA. And then from there, now we've grown, and our membership is now over 150 people representing 22 different federal agencies, intelligence community, DOD, civilian agencies. Again, I think just building that community of people, sharing those best practices and the information, standardizing across the government. I think there's no really end in sight for the great work that we can achieve with Jazzy, and just excited to be a part of it.
I think Jazzy has been an amazing educational advance in the cost community and in the project management community. The Jazzy IPT started as a way to communicate of how to estimate agile software projects, and it was a joint collaboration between NSA, NGA, and Department of Homeland Security. And it's since broadened its footprint. I think it's well over 15 other federal agencies that are now part of the activity. So just in collaboration from that broader community that's interested in agile estimation and planning was significant. We also participate in the Software Engineering Institute's Agile IPT. We cross-pollinate with them. So that's been a very good interaction. So the educational and sharing aspect of that has been its business biggest impact to date so far. And I know DHS has adopted A lot of the practices that we piloted together up and down their acquisition chain on their new business development.
I think it's great to be part of an organization that is trying to tackle the same problems that we are, and kind of knowing that we're not alone out there. There's certainly a framework of information there that's very helpful, and we certainly learn every time we attend a meeting with Jazzy.
Most estimation organizations facing the same thing we are. They're facing bigger influx of demand, both for projects to build and for proposals to estimate. And Jazzy is working to build awareness and to spur discussion on techniques that can help us meet our estimation demand better and more accurately. We want to be an integral part of the decision-making process. And if we can stay there because we can do things better, faster, more responsively, then we win and our customers win.
One thing that we're doing that we'll reap the benefits from is a standard way of collecting data and a standard way of, or standard guidance for how to actually go out and estimate the cost of software development and then track the progress of it. The more that we can exploit a best practice and a standard way of doing business, the more that I think you'll see common results on the tail end, which can only improve the way we do business in the future.
One of the things which is near and dear to me is trying to get some standardization and consistency with the requirements practice, at least in the federal space. That's one of the things that the Jazzy IPT has pioneered, is a lexicon of adverbs, which we're trying to use so that we can start analysis of requirements and user stories in a consistent fashion. We need to come up with a common understanding when someone asks for a capability. It gets, at least the starting of the analysis gets performed in a consistent fashion.
All right. Kevin, I know we went out of order there, so I'll loop back to the question we missed, but do you have anything to add on the Jazzy?
Yeah, I do. So first of all, the group is, I think Cammy mentioned it, gone from, four people, a couple agencies, to 20 agencies, 150 people. Definitely the standardization, how software estimation should be done. And then Dave pointed out that what Jazzy has developed is a lexicon, basically, set of terminology, phrases that translate into functional size. We'll get to that on the AI video in a second. But really, you heard it from the leaders, from Dave and from Katie, the goal, or the, well, not the goal, but what Jazzy has provided is a standardization in both in requirements analysis and in the software estimation process.
Yeah. And in case people are wondering, we do give a nod to ICEAA at the end with a video by Carol Deckers, who was part of the CBOC group.
So, if my organization isn't one of the 20 or so feet that's currently part of Jazzy, how would I get in contact with them or learn more, or attempt to leverage some of the good work that they've completed, or integrate it with requirements that maybe my organization has already standardized or developed?
Sure. So what I would do, first of all, I believe Cammy's on the call. Cammy, if you're on, feel free to jump in. But reach out to Cammy. It's open to government. There's a meeting in February. There's a quarterly meeting, and the group has published notes the files, templates that they use, that I'm sure they is open to anyone that's a member.
Great, thank you. I'll circle up with Cammy.
Okay. Let me see. This next video that we're going to take a look at has to do with the influence of artificial intelligence.
Hey, Ed, can I grab you just before you start that video? Because we got a question in, I think, my apply
sure.
Here. Is there interest in including OEM, the original equipment manufacturers, industry partners as well?
Can you unmute the person that asked that question and ask them to elaborate?
Okay.
Let's see if.
Whoever asked that question, I want to know if you're asking if an OEM can join Jazzy.
Doesn't look like.
Okay.
Doesn't look like, yes, he's asking if OEM people can join Jazzy. It doesn't look like he's logged in such a way that I can unmute him.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. Cammy says, no, I'm just going to put Cammy on the line. Cammy says, no, you can't.
Okay.
That's too bad.
Not much elaboration needed there.
No, not at all.
Cammy, you're backstage now. You can speak whenever you like.
Are you there, Cammy? Cammy, okay. Well, while she's working on her microphone, we'll just keep going. The bottom line is you can see Cammy for membership or attendance in Jazzy. Unfortunately, you do have to be either a government, a Fed, or you have to be sponsored by somebody in the federal government. I think that's correct, Cammy, but once you get your microphone situated, you can correct me if I'm wrong.
Okay. So one thing I'll point out is that you'll hear on the AI presentation about a tool we have. It's called Cadence. It does automated functional sizing. There's definitely a lot of crossover between its members and Jazzy. We are having a users group meeting later this month, and that is open to OEM. Whoever asked that question, please reach out to me. Would like to pull you into our group if you're interested.
Okay.
I think there's a real opportunity to begin taking data sets together, aggregating them, and looking at trends over time to inform future analysis. I don't think there's going to be a world in which AI replaces a cost analyst, right? I think it's whether you're doing data analytics or you've got the capability for machine reading and potential forecasting of things, that you still need a human to help interpret those results. But I think there's quite a wealth of opportunity to aggregate data, begin looking at trends across the board to help inform the current situation or program that you're supporting.
I'm not sure yet about machine learning and AI. I think they're going to have a place. I'm not sure that the underlying data yet that's supporting the estimates is technically advanced and consistent enough to support machine learning and AI yet. But I think the analytic part of that is going to be key and critical.
I think, 20 years from now, AI, I'm thinking if all the things that AI has taken over, it should be able to take over cost estimation. I think in terms of the functional analysis, I think you can do that in reverse for completed systems, and maybe that's a direction that would bring more data into the analysis realm that could be used to streamline the estimation process.
I think it could have a huge impact, especially depending on how AI eventually evolves. Having the ability to almost instantaneously generate estimates, right, if you have the right tool that can do things like size the software and then develop the parametric estimate based on that sizing with little or no human intervention would be a game changer.
Some more access into the IT execution organizations would help us mature what we're doing and maybe give those AI tools more input data.
We wanted to start doing estimates in an agile or DevSecOps fashion as possible so that we're only adding what's required in terms of additional effort and overhead on our projects when we implement them and then go back and measure them. So the analytics are going to enable that measurement part. And I think we need to get smarter in looking what information is there right now in the tool environments on the team side with these software factory and DevSecOps tool stacks.
I feel like parametric estimation tools are extremely valuable, and I don't think they're used widely enough. And a lot of times that's because they are cost prohibitive the way they are set up licensing. If you think about those types of tools in a software as a service environment where you pay as you go, you pay per use, per model that you build. Right. I could see that innovation having an extreme impact on the accessibility of those types of tools.
Go ahead, Kevin.
So my thought is that despite what Dave said, I don't think Alexa is going to replace all the cost estimators out there. As we get into the future, you know, clearly you're going to, you know, there's a lot of talk about AI and machine learning. It will have a greater role. I thought what Ian said was interesting, whether the parametric vendors would go into a SaaS model. I think it's important that tools could have greater use, but they also have to be more adaptable be able to analyze current trends and software development.
Yeah, and to be fair, asking people what type of impact AI is going to have on your industry or your field, that is a pretty tough question. And you can see from the responses that, you know, folks were thinking beyond AI and they were thinking about, you know, the other types of technology that might be injected into their field that might help. So the panelists, I think, all did a really good job of trying to field the question. So Cammie, just go ahead and break in at any time if you got your microphone fixed.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yay. Okay. Sorry for my technical difficulties. Yeah. Thanks guys for letting me chime in. So yeah, unfortunately, due to FACA rules, we're only allowed to have government folks be part of the Jazzy organization with support contractors who have permission from their government clients and are on contracts that their scope of work supports that. So I'm really sorry we can't have other folks be part of it, but we definitely would love any government folks who are interested to email me to join, and I'll post my email in the chat. So thanks guys for promoting Jazzy.
Yeah, is there any hope that that's gonna change in the future, that you're gonna be able to widen the scope a little bit?
Yeah, unfortunately not, because there's certain federal regulations that if we want to do that, we have to jump through a ton of hoops and basically open it up to the public, kind of similar to how the DOD has, you know, their advisory group. And basically our legal counsel has told us that the juice is not worth the squeeze, so to say, for those rules. So at this point, no. So yeah, it's the Federal Advisory Committee Act. If you're interested in Googling that, just to see kind of the regulations there that we're dealing with. So.
Okay. All right. Great. Thank you, Cammie, for weighing in. All right. So we have we got two more videos to go that I think is going to take about 5 to 10 minutes here. Daniel, how are we doing on time?
I've got 12, 13, so I think we're doing good.
Okay. Okay. All right. Great. So we'll just launch into the next one here, which was a fairly broad question. What is the future of the field? So really, we just wanted to give folks another opportunity to chime in and to speak more broadly about what they saw the changes to the field being.
We need to become more agile, bottom line. Like, we are the ones that need to flex to where we're moving with agile, with DevSecOps. We need to flex in our end product and what it looks like. We need to flex in our process to get there. We need to become more astute in the technical field so that we can support and speak our customers' language. All of those things in one package.
How do we take the tools and methods that we know how to use, you know, from building from the ground up, and use them, apply them in different scenarios? One of the new big things on the scene is low code applications. How do you take the estimation methods and tools that you have? How do you apply that to this sort of new technology, new platform, new approach to development. Being able to take a look at those different challenges that we have as estimators and in the technology industry, and to think about ways to apply tools and techniques and methods in a way that's innovative and outside the box, and maybe not a way we would have thought about it. I think that's the type of innovation that is essential to keep things going.
I think we're going to see more streamlining, less paralysis by analysis kind of situations, and focus more on getting a good enough estimate for what we need, getting away from these risk-adjusted, high degree of certainty point estimates, and going into a range of likely outcomes would probably be the best approach given the increasing prevalence of Agile.
Automation is going to be critical because we're seeing more projects, shorter time window to deliver an estimate. Estimates can be broader. Any tool that can help facilitate more estimates quicker at a reasonable level of certainty is going to be good to have.
The other thing I think is essential is I feel like parametric estimation tools are extremely valuable, and I don't think they're used widely enough. And a lot of times that's because they are cost prohibitive the way they are set up licensing. If you think about those types of tools in a software as a service environment where you pay as you go, you pay per use, per model that you build. Right. I could see that innovation having an extreme impact on the accessibility of those types of tools.
We have to change that paradigm of what a deliverable is. It's no longer what we touch, feel, smile at. It is the end result of some of those things from the past. If we're in a world that is agile and that's primarily what we're focusing on, then we need to be intellectually agile and then take all of the hard stuff, all of the hard data and analysis and use that and then roll that into our intelligence to help make better decisions.
You're going to get hacked if you haven't already. It's just a way of life. Ransomware is on the rise. So we really, as the government, need to be diligent to stay ahead of our adversaries. And that really needs to be baked in. And you really need to have a security part of your pipeline and part of each Agile team, right? That's incorporating that into all of the code while it's being developed, before it even goes to testing or goes out to production. Yep. This really needs to be an integral part. So in terms of estimating, include an additional security person in each one of your Agile teams as part of that level of effort buildup, but it really needs to be an essential part from the beginning.
Okay, go ahead, Kevin.
Some interesting comments. So both Katie and Tyrese talked about, as estimators, that our community needs to be more agile. What that means to me, it's not going to be, the industry's not going to be based on the 5 to 10 year LCCE. It's going to be based on building scenarios, building modeling different alternatives for your customer, because they're agile, they're going to be pivoting. Cammy made a great point on cyber. I think cyber is not an area that a lot of estimators spend a lot of time thinking about, but that's going to be a major part going forward. So I think, and then finally, I liked what Tyrese had to say about, you know, what is a deliverable? It may be different than the paperweight, you know, 150 page basis of estimate, but again, it may be something that actually is more useful in terms of a scenario analysis for for your customer.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that by saying that Dan French's response was really interesting. Yep. As well. I mean, he really talked about cutting out all the things that you don't need in or that the customer doesn't need in a cost estimate, and giving them a range of likely outcomes, something that they can really use. And that I think that is that's kind of the takeaway that I got from almost all of the panelists, is that they want to cut out the boilerplate in this methodology, and they want to give the customers what they can use.
I'm personally interested in the folks in the audience. There are a lot of you know, a lot of the folks are probably more hardware estimation backgrounds, not in all cases, but this may be not something you're used to hearing in terms of the changing deliverables. Just interested to see if other folks in the industry agree or disagree with what we heard.
Yeah, especially those that are impacted by the acquisition, the new acquisition pathway, that DOD put out, that repositions cost estimation within the acquisition process, and it really streamlines it and makes cost estimation more, it forces cost estimators to be more responsive and more iterative in the way that they do business. So definitely the folks that are working in DOD, feel free to chime in. Okay, so the next thing that we'll go over really quickly, I think this should take no more than about 3 or 4 minutes. This is Carol Deckers, and she's talking about CBOC, her role in it, and how that is evolving here.
The contract with ICEAA, International Cost Estimation and Analysis Association, to write their software CBOC, which is the cost estimation body of knowledge, is kind of a dream job. And when it comes to software is not really a commodity. Software requires, you know, an intensive labor of really getting the size of what you're building correct, but it's a little bit more elusive. And the software development processes are not necessarily something that is intuitive to, say, hardware estimators or anything else. And you take a look at the amount of money that we spend on software and systems development. Even if software is a portion of something, it can be pretty major. Management needs estimates. Maybe not at the, you know, sprint level, but we certainly need measurement, and we need it to be consistent and repeatable. The biggest thing we've stressed in the software CBOC is normalization, and that you know what's in the numbers. If you don't know those things, then I don't care what you're estimating, there's going to be an issue. So there has to be ways to quantify, to measure, and have that repeatability of exactly what's being delivered. I think for a very long time, one of the impediments to doing functional sizing has been that you need so much detailed information. We've got, you know, all these hybrid technologies in these terms, and we've incorporated that into the software CBOC. The number one principle in the software CBOC is data-based or data-founded estimate. So I think in the past, what's happened is estimates have become forecasts. Estimates have become targets. It should be a transparent process. Every single cost estimator, every single expert that I've encountered in the writing of the software CBOC has been absolutely highest integrity. We want something consistent. Story points doesn't cut it. Velocity will work only during our project. But let's get together with the rest of the industry and use something that's standardized, like function points or simple function points or estimated simple function points, because that gives you a line in the sand.
Okay, so that was Carol Decker. She's doing great work with ICEAA, working in the CBOC. Let's see. I think that was our last video. Kevin, do you want to say any words to wrap up here and then turn it back over?
Yeah, personally, I'm interested in hearing more about software, hearing more about the CBOC at the next ICEAA conference in May. There was a lot of what Carol mentioned, a lot of things you heard the other SMEs discussing, you know, consistency, repeatability in processes. And she closed by talking about simple function points. That's something that the Jazzy Group is also promoting. And I think if you're going to get into functional sizing, definitely read up on simple function points. It's an easier way to do sizing. It makes it basically it can allow more people to become software estimators because it makes the sizing process easier.
Yeah. And I'll just add that, you know, changes to a field like cost estimation don't always come quickly. And, you know, for somebody like me, I got involved in cost estimation probably during its heyday, you know, when it was almost at its pinnacle. That was in the late 90s and the early 2000s. But you know, every field has to evolve and has to change in some way. I think what we found out through these conversations is that change can come from a lot of different places. It can come from the very top through policy, and we've seen that with the acquisition pathway. It can come through lower levels, through management, through customers, program managers, project managers. But it can also be influenced by the people that are doing the analysis themselves. And that's something that I think I would encourage folks out that are watching this and that are members of ICEAA to do is really to innovate within the field, and also to push for change. So. Okay. Daniel, did you want to take this, or am I giving it back to George?
I think we want to open up for Q&A, I believe.
Oh, that's right, Q&A. Thank you. So yeah, let's take a second for Q&A here.
Yeah, I know I have one on here. We got a comment from the audience, not so much a question, and it includes a YouTube link, so it's kind of hard to speak. But someone suggests a video from a guy named Steve McConnell, who has a lecture on estimates, targets, and commitments. You guys can find that link in the chat.
Sounds good.
And I would say, Dan, why don't you go ahead and say your pieces so that everybody in the audience who've been waiting so patiently and so politely to send your questions, you can go ahead and send them now while Dan's talking, and then we'll get to him when he's done.
Yeah, thanks, Megan. Thanks, Ed, Kevin. Yeah, absolutely. Start getting those questions in. I did want to, can we go back one slide? I think that's the, we definitely want to save some time for Q&A, but it is a couple minutes to 12:30. So I'll just do some wrap up real quick, and then we'll do a lot of Q&A, I hope. I know I've got some questions and comments still. We do want to make sure everybody, please take the survey on the luncheon today. I believe we've got the link easily available for you in the chat, so there's no need to try to write down that a bunch of random text. Your feedback is really helpful when we're planning these events, and again for that award at the end of the year that we'll have. Next slide, please. I do want to take a nod to the benefits of ICEAA membership. If you're with us today and you're not a member, that's good. We definitely want you here, and we want you to get this good content as well. But I do really want to stress the benefits of membership. You do get discounts on your exams. You get discounts on a bunch of things. You get access to that Career Development Center, which can be really helpful, especially when you're newer in your career, if you're looking to break into management. It's a great access, great place to get some good feedback and knowledge on how to possibly do that. And then, like we heard about CBOC software, CBOC is coming up. Being a member is going to make it a lot easier and cheaper for you, I believe, to get access to that as well. So although we in the Washington area chapter like to keep these types of luncheons open to everybody, we do think there's a real benefit to signing up and becoming a member. Next slide, please. We've got a quick slide here with membership costs, which of course nobody wants to pay the membership costs. And so I do recommend you talk to your local HR representatives. We in the chapter are starting to collect information on the major organizations that our members work in, and it come to find out that some of your offices will pay your membership, and obviously that just sweetens the deal when it comes to membership, and more to come on that as well. Next slide, please. Just a couple quick shout outs to things that we've got going on. We did just recently post the survey results to the chapter survey that we sent out last November. I think they're pretty interesting. We've just got some quick and dirty GG plot summaries of them. But I see, a real clear demand signal. We've got some folks that really want more in-person events. We've got some folks that are really like, ooh, you really got to get through COVID first. We're going to do what we can to support both of those and try to do both things simultaneously. We also see a real big demand signal for data visualization and some more advanced sort of like, maybe data science-y type work. And so you will see in the next couple of months, we're going to be targeting luncheons and different topics that can hopefully give our members interesting feedback in that avenue. Next slide, last slide. We do the annual chapter awards. It's that time of year again. Please do, if you know somebody that's had a great presentation, finished a great analysis, that's deserving of an award, please do take a look at the link. We'll make sure we get that sent out, or you can see it in your email address or on our website. Nominate that person, make sure they can get acknowledgement for that good hard work, and we'll present it to them later in the year when we have our all members meeting. You can see the deadlines are on the slide there as well. Lastly, final thoughts, if you have a presentation, you have a product you want to get out there to the group, you know, we're always eager to hear about different luncheon ideas that our folks, our chapter members may have. So drop a line at that email address and we'll get you worked into the schedule. Thank you, Ed. Thank you, Kevin, so much for today. Thanks, George, for helping set it up, and Megan for helping with everything. I really do appreciate everybody both attending and presenting. Over from me.
Yeah. Thanks, Dan. George, do you have anything you want to add?
I have nothing else to add, but thank you very much for everyone attending. It's been a great kickoff, and thank you, Logapps, for having our first luncheon. Appreciate it.
We appreciate the opportunity, and it was a pleasure to present. Megan, do you have any questions?
We didn't get any questions, so you guys are just doing a bang up job. Okay. You know, you've impressed everybody into silence, but I actually kind of want to make a comment. I think it was one of the videos you said one of the guys was talking about how products are no longer things anymore. Things aren't, it may not be a pile of paper. ICEAA is all of those things. It's discounts and it's newsletters and it's conferences, but what it really is a community. And I have not seen a group of professionals more willing to help each other out and answer an email, you know, if you're stumped with something. So being a part of ICEAA is really a real gateway to get to be able to be in touch with all these people and expand, not just, I just say expand your network, because that just seems so flimsy, but it gives you access to people who can really help you out in a jam and learning about new things like today. So I think it's a little more than discounts, personally.
Okay. Dan, you mentioned that you might have some questions. Do you have anything? If not, we'll just we'll close it up.
Oh yeah, no. One item you asked earlier, what do we see in the federal space, and also making good copy. It's more than just good discounts. Sorry if I made it sound that way. But you all mentioned what are we seeing from the federal side on the way software works, and I'll just note that from my perspective, the new pathways have really made it more complex to do estimates. We've got a lot of what I'm starting to see are hardware programs that inherit software from a software program. Well, do I need to estimate that software program? Is that software GFI to that government program? What, you know, it's become really difficult to disentangle the hardware programs from software programs, and where does one start and where does one end, and how do the impacts on one's budget ripple into the other budget? That's been something that I've noticed. And one other thing that's always struck me is when talking to folks about agile-based software, you ask them, well, how much money do you need? What's it going to cost? And they come back with, we'll spend as much as you give me. You give me more, we'll do more sprints, we'll give you more capability. You have less money, we'll have fewer sprints and less capability. And that's been a real hard nut to crack from my perspective, and really eager to hear how sort of the community manages that type of or figures out that type of estimate given that type of funding and execution strategy.
Oh. Yeah, please weigh in, folks. So a couple of points. It's interesting that you say that the estimates are more complex now, and that understanding whether the estimate should be hardware or software. I don't know anything about that. It's interesting to hear you talk in those terms. I do recall seeing the presentation and seeing that the differentiation is whether or not it is a back office business system or if it's an embedded system. And I guess what you're talking about, Dan, is those embedded systems. So yeah, that sounds like a tough one to crack. And then the second part, I lost the bubble there. What was the second part of your?
It was kind of the design to cost, the idea that you had a fixed.
Design to cost, yeah. Okay, so the design to cost, that's really typical of these agile programs, is that they start off with a budget, and then they tell you what the team can deliver with that amount of money, you know, which is really interesting, and that is part of the agile process, you know, very very broad, high level requirements in the beginning, and then lots of iteration and lots of figuring out what type of product you're going to get at the end. So this was a big deal, you know, when Agile really started to take a foothold. You know, it started to turn cost estimation around to where you're not always estimating cost, but a lot of times you're estimating what is going to be delivered. And I think one or two of our panelists had talked about that.
I just pointed out that in the DevSecOps world, keep in mind that in my opinion is that development teams, they want to talk in terms of features, but be aware there are other things. There's technical debt, there's defects, there's risks. This is all part of value stream measurement that you're going to hear more about. So really focus that even if it's, you know, fixed sprints, if the development team is talking with features, there are other pieces of work that they need to be doing, and that should be part of your estimate.
That's a good point. Okay. Any other questions? Dan, was that good? Okay. All right.
Loved it.
All right, excellent. Well, we're just a few minutes over. Thank you everybody for participating, and we look forward to seeing you at the next virtual luncheon. So have a good day, everybody.